Good afternoon. I'm Rick Barron, Executive Vice Chancellor for Health Affairs at MU and the Executive Director of NextGen. I want to welcome you to the fifth session of our NextGen Precision Health Discovery Series. These discussions are intended to showcase various areas and approaches to precision health. As you hear these wonderful talks, we would like you to think about research opportunities where we can identify potential collaborations across the University of Missouri system. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Wes Warren. Dr. Warren serves at the University of Missouri as Professor of Genomics in the Bond Life Sciences Center. He is an internationally recognized expert in comparative genomics. He earned his PhD in molecular endocrinology from MU in 1990, and he completed postdoctoral fellowships at Serum Pharmaceutical. He was on the faculty of Washington University in St. Louis from 2001 to 2018, where he was associate professor of genetics and the assistant director of the McDonnell Genome Institute. Then in 2018, he joined MU as a faculty member. His research involves how genome sequencing plays a role in both the health of individuals and our population-wide understanding of disease. Today, Dr. Warren will be sharing with us what the genomic core at MU means to the Next Gen Precision Health Initiative. He will discuss his MU Tier 1 team sequencing initiative, and he will discuss the power of sequencing to address all types of biological health and disease questions. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Dr. Wes Warren, and thank you again for being part of the Discovery Series.
Thank you very much, Dr. Barron, for that introduction. It's a very exciting times. And as you note from the title of my talk, Genomics Powered Medicine, you can see an artist rendering of the future precision health or next gen precision health building there. As we know, it's a little bit different than that, but we're very excited about the applications of what we're going to accomplish when we get all these investigators together for this various initiatives. So I think it's appropriate to start off with the mission statement that Dr. Barron shared with you in the first introductory seminar to these series. And that's shown here, and I'm not gonna read back the full statement, but I highlighted in yellow what I will focus on today, which is the research applications, as well as the applications in the clinic where it's appropriate. So there's a series of narratives that I'd like to share with you today. So I prepared this seminar with the concept of reviewing some of the literature, highlighting some of the applications of that research, as well as sprinkling in some of the collaborations that my lab has participated in to not only improve these narratives, but to contribute to an understanding of how to use genomic medicine. In our agenda, I will start out with a very brief history of sequencing. I think it's an important place to start because really the theme of this talk is all about how sequencing is a very powerful technology to improve the aspects or the applications of genomic medicine. And as many of you that are aware of my lab's efforts, and as Dr. Barron mentioned, is comparative medicine is one of the main themes, evolution specifically. And I think this is a key feature that my lab uses to try to understand how we will interpret all these variants and how we will treat patients better in the future. And this is really a segue to a series of slides that I'll share with you that previews past background information, past studies that got us to this point of being able to practice genomic medicine. And then I will give some application examples and some highlight some studies that where this is being used in cancer, which my lab is involved in several collaborations on this aspect. And I'll review in a very brief format rare and what I call rare and common diseases. And then I will end with a description of the MU Tier 1 sequencing initiative that Dr. Barron mentioned earlier. And I like to include this quote at the bottom here that really, I think, grounds a lot of the research that I work on. It says, nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. So I like to keep this in mind as we're starting to discuss these various interpretations of variants. And this is a great place to start. These are what I call sequencing statements. And these statements were really compiled by my colleague, Dr. Schnabel. And this is what we share with our MU students when we team teach the genomics course here at MU. And the first of that is really to help them understand that sequencing is a tool of many in your toolbox that can be applied to a specific question. So since it's a tool, you have to not try to get in this mindset that if all you have is a hammer, every problem looks like a nail. And this is a common saying, but this is a nice segue to understand the complications of just using this as a tool. And the other piece of this is, even though we like to be careful in how we describe the use of sequencing to these students, it's a fact that in the discipline of genomics, most of the questions involve some type of sequence information. So the measures of trying to understand a particular trait of interest typically will involve some type of sequence classification. And just when I believe that there's probably not many more ways that we could use different types of sequencing or develop new methods, I'm wrong. And so what we see today is this incredible amount of sequencing versatility and new applications all the time, constantly evolving. So just when you think you have a technique that's really powerful and useful, it likely is, but there's a new variation of it that will give you a new level or a higher resolution for what you're looking for. So these are just general statements about sequencing. So now in this very busy slide, this what I call condensed history of sequencing, I'll just highlight what I think are a few key discoveries or moments in history that led up to our ability to use sequencing as a tool. And the biggest piece of this slide is really kind of capturing that decade where we're trying to understand the human genome. But first, we start out with Gregor Mendel, who really discovered the principles of inheritance. And then if you fast forward to what those principles were, that what Mendel called elements, these elements were discovered by Watson and Crick to be DNA. And so then if you move forward up to 1985 and the discovery of PCR, and couple that with discovery of Sanger sequencing, the Human Genome Project was launched in 1990. And so over a period of about a decade, you can see various discoveries that were made. And really during that whole time period, there was a lot of learnings, a lot of mistakes made, and a lot of new developments. And one of the first genomes that we really learned a lot about how to sequence in a high throughput way was on C. elegans, or a worm. And that was done mostly with the Sanger Center in WashU at the time. And then in roughly around 2001, the consortium, and this of course was not only the academic groups, but the private domain with Craig Venter, developed what they've referred to as the finished human genome. And of course, finished is not really the best classification of the draft of the human genome at that point in time. But I will address some of this, some of these updates in terms of what that means in a few slides momentarily. But I was also fortunate to be on the tail end when I joined WashU around that 2000 period in the finishing phases of the human genome, where we're starting to try to close gaps and understand truly what the human genome looked like. So it was an exciting time. And if you're really interested in some of the updated milestones associated with genomic sequencing, I would encourage you to download this particular summary article from Nature. And it's got a lot of great stories in there in terms of milestones, I would call them, for sequencing. One of my favorite, and again, I was able to participate at WashU, was the first establishment of the human microbiome in 2004. So we were able to assemble many, many prokaryotic species and develop this catalog. And since that time, this field has really bloomed. So that's just one example of many. And then going back to that concept of comparative medicine, I've been fortunate in the journey of my career is to think of all of the different diseases, or cancer as one example, and how to study these diseases is to look at the genomes, or I believe to look at the genomes of many different species. And what you have here is what I call like the building blocks of evolution, where we're starting to catalog all these genomes. These are examples of projects that I co-led or participated on or led over the course of my career. And if you look at the right side here, the non-human primates, we're still active in this area and trying to understand in terms of disease origin, how different segregating variants in these populations are closely related to the disease origin of variants that we find in human populations. And then if you move to the left at the bottom of the mammalian phylogeny, you have the platypus genome. And that's perhaps one of the most exciting projects I've participated in. And in this case, we're able to compare the platypus genome and really understand what makes us mammals. And then if you move farther to the left, roughly about 300 million years of evolution, we can see this beautiful rapid species radiation of the birds and understanding how that adaptation occurred over a short period of time. Moving farther down to the fish, where we have these very slow, ancient evolving vertebrates, gives us understanding of mutation rate and how slow mutation rate is different in compared to some of the admixture we see in the human population. And then finally, on the far left, we can look at some of these species that harbor parasites that are detrimental to ourselves in terms of the health consequences. And this is an example of in this particular case, is the tsetse fly, you know, transmitting the parasitic trypanosoma protozoa. So these all collectively, what I call a journey of trying to catalog more of these type of variants and understand their contribution to disease. And this is the framework that this is a very gross oversimplification of what I want to discuss today, which is trying to understand how genomics can better power precision health or precision medicine. Is often switched terminology there in terms of how it's referred to in the literature. And on your left here, I don't know if you can see my mouse, but the genomics side of this circled here with the red dashed line is what I'm going to try to focus mostly on today. Dr. Waitman has already discussed the electronic health records and the combination of, in some cases, genetic information with this powerful enterprise computing approach. And then the hope is that once we have better information and integration of these two pieces, that we can have information relayed to the physician. The physician will treat the patient and then provide feedback in terms of whether that works well or does not work well in terms of the type of information provided. And this creates what I call this improvement loop. And that goes back to the researcher who can then mine the data more thoroughly and provide new information back to the physician. And the hope is that this continual loop will refine our ability to use genomic medicine. And then the final outcome we want to see, and this is related to the mission statement that I made at the beginning of the talk, is we wanna see better patient health. We wanna be able to treat these patients and resolve the phenotypes that they're experiencing as best we can. And in terms of trial enrollments, whether it's for common diseases or cancer, we want to better match using genetic testing those patients to various types of trials, as well as when we have these very large sequencing efforts, we want to be able to discover new targets. Again, whether it's common diseases or cancer. And then finally, probably one of the most important pieces is to reduce the drag on our economy in terms of healthcare costs. If we can do this more efficiently, and I'll discuss more of this as we go here, this precision health approach and risk stratification is another way to think about that, then we can meet some of those milestones that we set forth. But now I'd like to cover what I call background information as a setup for why we're able to practice genomic medicine today. So the question I'm asking here is, what advances have made genomic medicine possible? So I want to cover a few of these to start. The first one is, if we're going to use a reference as our computational starting point, it has to be as high quality as possible. I mean, that's an obvious explanation, because if we don't have portions of the genome accurately assembled, ordered, and oriented, then when we map all these different reads and call variants, we're going to have errors occur and propagate those errors, and we don't want that. And the first real, I think, big success story of really getting to the point where we don't have any gaps in our information, don't have any gaps in our assembly, was recently published last year by Karen Niga's group in Nature, where they were able to produce a finished chromosome that is telomere to telomere, including the centromeric sequence for the X chromosome. Now, since this time in the past year, they've also done chromosome 8 in human and a few non-human primates as well. And over on the right here, you can see some of my lab's collaboration with Dr. Lyons here at MU, as well as Dr. Murphy at Texas A&M, where we're looking at the feline, a variety of feline species. And what's really interesting about this particular phylogenetic classification of mammals is you can see, if you drop down here and look at the color coding for domestic cat contigs, using a phasing approach where we're actually able to look at a hybrid, in this case, between an Asian leopard and a domestic cat, we can completely phase that diploid genome into its parental equivalents. And when we do that and use these long read sequencing technologies, we're able to, in some cases, for example, look at A3 here, we can produce a contig with no gaps, telomere to telomere. And we've been able to do this in this particular publication for 5 different chromosomes of the cat. And this is a big development in terms of applying this technology to other species. And we're very excited about using this technique to move forward with other species of interest. And to further, I would say, highlight what we've been able to do with this, this year we were able to publish what I call a game plan in Nature. And what this is it's a consortium that I'm a part of that's called the Vertebrate Genomes Project, where the goal is to characterize and sequence and assemble the genomes of over 70,000 vertebrate species. And what we published here is this game plan on using this phasing approach and other techniques that were learned over the course of the last few years in order to produce these complete drafts of these human genomes or other species of interest. And as of this week in Nature News, if you've been looking at Nature, it's very exciting that the first complete genome, that headline of this news is very close. And in this bioarchive preprint here shown with a link, they were able to produce a genome assembly of human of all the chromosomes except one. And you can probably guess what that one chromosome is. And I've been working on this particular chromosome over the last 10 years, 20 years of my career, and that's the Y chromosome. So the Y chromosome is the only one they have not been able to really nail down to this point, but this is a very exciting development. So now the question is, if we have this complete copies of our computational starting point, are we done? And the answer is unequivocally no. And the reason why is shown here in this slide. And if you look at this colored graph here, all these different colored lines, and then you look at the gray barred areas or the grayed out areas, and I apologize for the resolution here, but this highlights the extreme amount of variability we see in the human population. So if we were to use one linear reference and map all the different reads of these human admixed population, we would lose quite a bit of information in terms of this quest for highly accurate variant ascertainment. So what was born out of this observation is the Human Pangenome Initiative, shown here down with this logo. Over here to the right are all the different groups, and my old group at WashU is working on this. And you can see with all these different representations of new genome assemblies, this group is now looking at the phylogenetic tree of human, and they've chosen over hundreds of human samples to really best represent that human phylogeny. And this effort is underway now. And what will become of this is this beautiful, what we call pangenome graph of the reference, so that when we map reads to this type of reference in the future, we will lose very little information. And this is particularly important for structural variation. So we're very excited about these applications. And my lab is using these techniques for some of the domesticated animals that we're working on. And then the last bit of background that I will share with you, this so-called preview to genomic medicine, is what I describe as the genotype to phenotype quest. And you'll see here three major projects, over the last two decades have been developed. The one on the far left here is genome-wide association studies, and this 2007 catalog, although outdated, really nicely illustrates the point in that we have lots of single nucleotide polymorphisms or SNPs that are associated with healthy and disease traits. And most of these SNPs fall in the areas that are not protein coding genes. And so the next project that arose to try to understand their role was the ENCODE project. And that's where they're looking at lots of sequence and perturbing those sequences upstream of these protein coding genes and seeing how it affected the expression of these genes. And then a nice segue to that is what's called the GTEx project, where they're looking at SNPs that are controlling the expression of one specific gene across multiple tissue types over developmental time. And so this is a really nice and series of studies that were just published in 2020, or I should say some of the big findings were published in 2020. There are early publications for this project as well. So this now gets us even better resolution to try this quest to link a genotype to a phenotype. And then finally, one of the most exciting new technology developments that my lab is applying to most of the projects that we're working on is single cell biology or single cell technology. And in this case, we're using the transcriptome behavior of single cells to try to understand their relationship to each other and how they're different when you perturb the system. So we're involved in a lot of different projects to apply single cell technology. You'll hear about some of those today. So now I'm going to transition in our agenda to cancer. And we've got this nice background or preview for applying genomic technology to this genomic medicine. And one of the other things I forgot to mention is it's often referred to as precision medicine, but I had a really good colleague a while ago, a physician colleague, that told me, does this say that as physicians, we're not practicing precision medicine prior to genomics? And the answer, of course, is no. So I like to refer to this practice as genomic medicine. All right, so starting off and transitioning to applications in cancer, this slide I think nicely illustrates how, just like the human population being very adverse, or not adverse, admixed, and looking at cancer and asking that same question, we find that cancer is also highly heterogeneous, just like the human population. And what you see here is some diverse people sitting in this chair, and I've placed different organ systems in front of each, and to illustrate the fact that cancer is very wily and are very crafty, or however you want to say that, in its ability not only to evade the immune system, but also to evolve resistance to our standard of care, which is chemotherapy. And another point here is you can have the same gene, have the same mutation across cancer, different cancer types, and the morphology and how that cancer progresses or not is very different. So a very complex problem, and hence why we're still doing lots of research here to try to understand how we can make progress. So here's, I think, a great illustration of the problem we face. And I borrowed this slide from my good colleague at WashU, Dr. Tim Lay. And I love this quote that he made at a presentation kind of describing this to a more general audience at WashU, and that says, cells with initiating events persist from beginning to end and must be eliminated for cures. And so Dr. Lay works on AML, is mostly what he works on, a bloodborne cancer. And what you see here is a simplification of what we're dealing with in terms of how to treat cancer. On the left, you have steady state hematopoiesis, and you have this mutation that occurs in a methyltransferase gene, DMT3A, and then you have a proliferation of that particular population. And then you have a new mutation that arises in MP M1, and then you have a proliferation of that population and a rescinding of the other population. And then you have new mutations that occur in FLT3 and IDH1. And as you can see, where we're pointing to IDH1, this becomes what's referred to as this founding clone for AML. And you see these subclones arise in the next iteration of this here. And then you have the standard chemo treatment. And then unfortunately, you have the remission period of time. And you see this particular, what we call the initiating clone, is still there at a very low frequency of these populations, these clonal lineages. And then eventually you get the relapse. And this is again back to this problem that Dr. Lay has outlined in terms of how do we treat these patients better and match therapies against these types of mutations. So the good news is there's a lot of new monotherapy drugs that are being targeted. And I think in the last year, just checking my notes real quickly, I believe we had up to 27 new drugs that were approved by the FDA in 2019. That's a 35% increase from the prior year. So there are more monotherapies or drugs that are being targeted against specific somatic mutations coming onto the market. But I think although these are very encouraging, there's still a lot of work to be done. And I think this particular slide really highlights what I refer to as our precision oncology expectations met is the question. And to your left there, you can see one of the more recent trials where they attempted to match somatic mutations that were discovered using sequencing approaches to a variety of drugs that are available that target these mutations. And after you, we don't have time today to go into all the details, and we could do a full seminar on just this trial and what the outcomes were. The answer to that question is not yet, the short answer to that question. And what I'll highlight here is a few bullet points. This is, of course, non-small cell lung cancer. Roughly 63 of all the patients that were profiled using sequencing have these tier 1, tier 2 gene aberrations, which basically are genes that we know in some shape or form are contributing to tumorigenesis. But the big telling point here is only 14% are eligible for treatments. So even though you're finding all these somatic mutations in those genes, being able to match these against drugs and all the other aspects of enrolling these patients made the success of using that screening not as encouraging as we had hoped. And the biggest problem, the point that we'll make here, is when you start to look at all these genes that are eligible, is there's not enough drugs to treat them. So sorry, I had to turn my light back up. And that is a big problem. We're aware of that, and there's lots of work being done to do this. But more importantly, when we're starting to think about mechanism of action and where do we go with genome medicine applications, the drugs we do have, in some cases, there's wonderful success stories, like for the EGF receptor when we target that for certain types of lung cancer. But for many of these, as I illustrated earlier for the AML story, they develop resistance and you have relapse. So what is it that allows these clones with these initiating events to develop resistance? And that's the point I wanted to pursue here as we discuss some of the applications. And then the last point I'll make on this particular trial is this was a perspective piece that was written to summarize this lung matrix trial, which is an umbrella trial and is focused on aligning monotherapy, in some cases combinatorial therapy, of these gene mutation targeted drugs with other combinations like chemotherapy. But these authors highlighted in red here, I think really summarize nicely what the future is. And that is the protocols of the future really need to mimic the various attributes of these cancers we are trying to treat. And so again, this goes back to my point about the high heterogeneity and the individualistic presentation of tumors in all these different patients across the population. So at MU, here's an example where I wanted to highlight a collaboration that was initiated with Dr. Peter Todd Lotto, Yusuf Kaifi, and John Mitchum over here at the bottom. And what we needed to do, or felt we needed to do at MU, is to start to generate data on MU patients, and more importantly, gain more experience in trying to understand or interpret those variants and apply that knowledge to what we learn about these patients. So what you're seeing here is 33 lung cancer exomes. And you can see most of these are very early stage one patients. And then here are the various genes with the most recurrent somatic mutation events. And then they're characterized over here to the right. Most of these are non-synonymous. And for those of you that don't know what that means, that's simply an amino acid changing mutation. So you might change it from a lysine to a tryptophan, as an example, in that protein. And as we've seen in many other studies, that the TP53 gene is most often the gene that is hit with various somatic mutations. And on the bottom here, you can see the profile for this very small sampling of lung cancer exomes and the different types of mutations that we found in the P53 gene. So again, this comes back to my point of the high heterogeneity of cancer, and what we can do in the future is to try to get better functional classification of these variants and how we might stratify these patients for better treatments. To do that, we're going to have to do a better job of interpretation using a variety of bioinformatic tools. And here I'm highlighting one of those really nice databases, which is the CB Bio portal. And this is a wonderful tool for looking at recurrence and other types of information, getting details about these variants. And then one that we're working on, and my lab is collaborating with various groups, is to try to implement this MatchMiner software from the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, which is an open source computational platform that allows us to better match these somatic mutation profiles to a variety of precision cancer medicine clinical trials. So we're very interested in learning how well this process works and, you know, gaining from the experience of the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. And to do that, we needed some help. And so before I get to that, actually, here's an example of what that output might look like. And this is a simulation provided by Dr. Ethan Cerami. And you can see in this hypothetical example here, when the somatic mutation profiles are input along with other phenotypes for this patient, there is 5 clinical trial matches shown here. And then you can see them listed. And the oncologist with this type of information can make decisions on best how to treat the patient, or if available, they can enter them in a clinical trial here at MU or perhaps at a local hospital that's near them in a community setting. So this is one of the big challenges that we see, is trying to take all this data that's being generated, not only for the exome example here, where we're trying to just look at this from a research standpoint, from the many oncogene panels that are being tested. And there's groups here at MU that are doing this now and looking at the information provided and trying to understand if there's clinical trial matches. And you recall in the last seminar given on this topic, Dr. Hammer covered a lot of the details related to what the status is for that type of application here at MU. But again, our interests are in the research side and trying to understand how patients are matched and what somatic mutation profiles are most meaningful for that process. To really set this up, we needed some help. And I think this is a good opportunity for me to introduce the new resurrection, I should say, of the MU Informatics Research Corps. And that's led by Dr. Lyndon Coghill down here at the bottom is his picture. And I'm not gonna go over all the statements here in terms of the services, and you can read the mission statement. But suffice to say that the goal here is to provide a lot of well-documented with good workflows, these various bioinformatic analysis capabilities. And they're all, you know, listed here. So I would highly encourage you, if you have bioinformatic needs, to consult with Dr. Coghill to set up experimental designs and determine what types of services they may offer you, or in some cases, even work with them on grant applications in terms of what you want to do. So we're working to evolve this group and make it stronger and stronger. and make the application of these type of bioinformatic analysis more routine and available to all MU PIs across the system. Now, before we leave the topic of cancer or this field, this discipline, I wanted to share with you, as I mentioned earlier, the single cell technology applications that my lab frequently will highlight and use in a variety of studies. And what you're seeing here is just a metastasis model that Dr. Kaifi has developed. And this project was led by postdoc Suvalesh with lots of great computational contributions from Yulia Inokoteva. And what is developed in this lab is resecting the primary tumor of a lung cancer, growing it in an immunodeficient mouse called the PDX model, enriching for circulating tumor cells, and then growing those in another immunodeficient mouse. And unfortunately, this process of growing harvesting CTCs and growing them in immunodeficient mice is not very efficient. But when we're able to do that, we learn a lot about this transition from the primary to the metastatic state. And when we applied single nuclei sequencing approaches to this, in the bottom here, you're seeing two different patients where there was a resection that occurred and we successfully completed this whole process. And I'm not going to go into the details today, and it may be hard for you to see, but if you look down here at these what we call AT2-1 and AT2 populations, in the primary we have one, and in the metastatic state or the CDX model, we always see two of these populations. And this was repeated in two different examples, and obviously we need to repeat this more often. But when we took a larger data set of single cell nuclei data from an external group that was looking at primary and metastatic tumors, they found this same observation where you have this one cluster of this AT2 population and then it develops into two. And our analysis pipeline evaluated this as well just to replicate, and we find the same observation. And since this time, we've also found a third independent study that finds this very unique divergence of, or let's say a subtype population of the AT2 is emerging. And what this means and kind of how to interpret the molecular mechanism action is something we're continuing to pursue today. But again, this highlights the real powerful approach of single cell technology for looking at molecular mechanism of action. Now I'm going to shift gears again on you, a new narrative in looking at common and rare diseases. And in this recent publication, looking at more of the economic impact, the most often question that's asked about the application of sequencing and investing all this money in sequencing all these different patients or human individuals is, what's the economic impact of this? And in this nice summary article co-sponsored by the American Society of Human Genetics, the authors nicely justify lots of that investment and showing how the discovery of a lot of these different segregating variants is important for risk stratification and other things of that nature. And just to give you a flavor of the different types of studies that are underway and the large investment that's being made in this area, you can see a whole variety of countries that are really going very deep into this question of surveying the genomes of their populations. And I'll just highlight, probably the leader in this area right now is the United Kingdom. They were the first to put out this 100,000 set of genomes, and there's been lots and lots of groups mining this data with a lot of very interesting findings. And now they're really ramping this up to really look at a larger number in that population in the UK, up to 5 million. The US has its efforts as well. And so what I'll highlight here is not only will you discover interesting variants to try to understand whether they're benign or deleterious, but the goal here is to go back to that concept of GWAS and try to understand, can you look at these various segregating variants and calculate some kind of what they're calling polygenic risk score? And that's really the very large project that's underway. It's called All of Us, sponsored by the NHGRI. And their goal is to sequence up to 1 million individuals and, of course, collect lots of phenotypic information. And by having that depth of knowledge of the various segregating variants, their hope is to really fine tune their ability to stratify risk for a variety of diseases. But this perspective piece really highlights how challenging that is. And the main message here is, without more functional validation of what these variants do, it's going to be very difficult to really improve the accuracy of placing a polygenic risk score on an individual that you might characterize from a clinical standpoint. So a lot more work needs to be done here. So what has been done in the past, and kind of bring you up to date what's really being done now and in current present day, is the first study I would say that was very instrumental in trying to understand how sequencing large numbers of patients at the exome level in this case could be tied in with treatment or improving the health outcome of these patients. And this was a unique collaboration between a very large insurer in the Northeast called Geisinger and academic groups. And the main message here was they are seeing, and especially in the cardiovascular area, a lot of good actionable variants that they could target. And then the follow to that was a very large, as I mentioned earlier, that 100,000 number in the UK Biobank, where they published the analysis of roughly half of those individuals. And we found out a lot more about all the different types of variants that are segregating in this population. And then the most recent one is what's the TopMed project, which is sponsored by the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, called TopMed. And this was 53,000 individuals. And I'll just highlight a few of the good things and perhaps the challenges that we are facing. The most interesting feature, I would say, is we have roughly 5,000 genetic orders where the molecular causes are known. The problem is only about 59 genes where the American College of Medical Genetics states that we have available treatments where when you treat these patients with these type of mutations, you can reverse morbidity and mortality in these individuals. And then to further give you an overview of the types of mutations that are occurring, is there's over 200,000 of these putative loss of function variants covering the broad spectrum of the genes. And the average individual has 2.5 of these. So when we look at loss of function, there's a lot more that we need to do to really clarify whether these are benign or deleterious. And I've highlighted at the bottom here kind of one of those tools that allows us to look at this question, but there's more work that needs to be done here. And then I'll quickly highlight one of the other projects. If we change that risk perspective to rare diseases or undiagnosed diseases, this is a project that I participated in with the group. And here you can see the various color coding where they receive applications. This is the UDN project is what I'm referring to it as. Receive applications, and then these applications are under review. And what's really nice is roughly 33 of these cases are resolved using this pipeline. My participation has been, when I started at WashU, is looking at the Model Organism Screening Center and how could we use information to really improve the diagnosis of these uncharacterized variants. What got my attention was some of this machine learning or neural network analyses on using non-human primate data to look at this question. So once we discussed this with our WashU colleagues, we developed kind of a segue of a large project that I was part of that we were fortunate to publish this year in Science, and that's shown here. And I'll just highlight some of the main features we discovered here. You can see the principal components analysis here of the various populations, and here is just the primate centers that house all these rhesus macaques. And we find some of the same types of frequency for these alleles in the populations as human, and these rare loss of function mutations are very interesting here in the red. And if you transition over here to the far right, one of the narratives that we talked about in this paper was looking at roughly about 83 genes that are associated with cognitive decline or developmental delays and learning disorders. Is these two genes here, ARID and SHANK3. And what you're seeing highlighted here are the various loss of function or variants that we think will have high impact on the functionality of that protein. So the summary here is that these variants provide us a very good natural gene model for trying to study the outcome of a variety of systems if this particular gene has been disrupted in a primate model that's very close genetically to ourselves. And then the last part of the talk here, I want to cover the MU sequencing initiative. This was a program that was funded by, you know, the Tier 1 grants program, or I should say project. And the goal here was, of course, to create more collaborations across the different schools and colleges. And the paradigm is that we would be sequencing DNA and RNA in the front end of this process. And the goal, of course, was to bring to the university the state-of-the-art instrument for sequencing, which is the NovaSeq 6000. Our hope was that all of these different components of this initiative could be, or we could improve the various types of research efforts that are underway in a variety of disciplines. Here's the instrument, and I'm not gonna go into all the details of what its capabilities are, but the big one here, of course, is now we can sequence human genomes at about 30x coverage, which is a standard coverage used to find these segregating variants very cheaply, around $665. And high throughput, no matter which flow cell you use, is very much a capability of this new instrument. So this really brings us as a university and UM system up to state of the art with other institutions that are using high throughput sequencing to address a variety of questions. And then this leads to kind of adding to a toolbox, I would call it, for the DNA core that's led by Nathan Bivens down here in the corner. And here's all the information to contact the core. I don't know, most of you are probably familiar with this, but these are the various variety of services. And then with the sequencing capability we have now, there's no limitation in how many things we could accomplish using this approach. What are we doing with this initiative? We knew that if we purchased the instrument, put it into the core, made it available, we also needed to incentivize some of the smaller labs as well as labs that are well-known users of sequencing technology. And what you're seeing captured here from the various schools that contributing matching funds in order to incentivize these MUPIs is you can see various projects were developed in Kaffner, the School of Medicine, the Arts and Sciences, as well as the Veterinary Medicine applications. And just to give you a quick summary of where we are today, you can see at year one, we've been able to provide over $167,000 in what we call these small block grants to 20 different MUPIs. And so, as I mentioned, there's a lot of variety in what these projects are being used for. But one of the stipulations we had in reviewing these applications, or one of the review criteria, I should say, is we wanted to see an explanation of how this sequence data was going to be used. Is it going to strengthen a grant in terms of preliminary data? Is it going to improve the impact of a manuscript? Or does it make them more competitive in terms of some discovery that they're trying to make for a particular phenotype of interest? So all of these really nice projects were reviewed, and we again handed out this funding, and we're right now monitoring the progress of these various PIs and working with them on experimental design to make sure they're successful. And at the bottom here, you can see we didn't just have genome sequencing as one of the applications in these grants. These PIs are using all different techniques that are associated with sequencing, shown here, from genomics all the way to epigenomics. And then circling full circle back to our original simplification of this overview of genomic medicine, where we discussed a lot of different genomic applications and then integration of, in terms of the human applications, integration into EHR, and then this enterprise computing component improvement loop. And what I think, my personal opinion on the three major tasks going forward is we really need to better establish routine genome sequencing and focus sequencing of patients that come into the MU hospital system. The focus I'm referring to is either exomes or oncogene panels, which I already mentioned, we are starting to do more of the oncogene panel testing on site. I also believe that we need to pivot more to research that's focusing on the validation of these variants and what their impact is. This is not just MU. This is a universal need across all the institutions that are looking at functional validation. And you're starting to see some of the NIH funding calls really shift towards this type of focus on looking at variant prioritization in a high throughput way. And then finally, we need to partner more with people that have expertise that we don't. For one example is bioinformatics. We really need to improve our bioinformatics capabilities at MU. And we're doing that, and we need to continue to invest in this area. Not only for that, but also for recruiting new scientists that bring methodology that we don't have as much experience in. So all these things, I think, are crucial for us to be successful going forward. And then finally, I want to acknowledge all the people that have contributed to these different efforts. And I'm not capturing everybody, but I just wanted to call out a few individuals. I'm very thankful to Dr. Schnabel for keeping me on the straight and narrow for bioinformatics applications, Dr. Spencer for all his support and encouragement in terms of how to set up these various initiatives. And then my great colleagues on the cancer side are constantly improving my knowledge of the patient and how we treat the patient and what the outcomes should be. Lots of collaboration with Nathan at the DNA Core, great work with a lot of people, and I'll just highlight Yulia from the Informatics Data Science Institute that she Ren leads, my colleagues on the Tier 1 Sequencing Committee, and then all the different funding sources I have, as well as my collaborations with the Vertebra Genome Project. And last but not least are all the great people that are working in my lab, Ashley, who leads the lab, and then graduate students Elena and Rachel, and then finally Ed Rice. And I'll end it there, and I'm happy if we have time to answer any questions.
That was a great talk. I was amazed that on that one trial you talked about, only 14% of the people who are identified to have a gene were eligible for a trial in lung cancer.
Right.
And so, and that's, but I also had thought I'd heard that in if someone has a cancer, the chance that a clinician is actually ordering one of these panels is actually quite low to begin with.
Yeah, so there's
so that. You have both problems.
Yeah, you have that problem, and also the problem that when you put them on these monotherapies, toxicity develops. So in the details of that trial, there's a lot of patients that drop out due to toxicity, and there's other reasons as well. I mean, reimbursement reasons, there's lots of reasons why you start out in this particular trial. Initially, they had roughly 4,000 patients they were screened with next-gen sequencing. And at the end, they only ended up with about 300 patients that were on the trial. Yeah. So there's a large dropout, and we have to, you know, develop more drugs, as I mentioned, but we also have to do a better job of trying to match those mutations against these monotherapies.
All right, Mary, I'll be quiet. Do you want to read any questions that came in?
So we don't have any yet.
I was
going to share the information about next month as maybe some people are typing in, hopefully, their questions in the Q&A function there on the bottom of the screen. But next month we'll have, you mentioned WashU quite a bit during your presentation, Dr. Warren, and next month we're having Dr. Christina Gurnett share her presentation on the precision health experience at WashU in St. Louis. Dr. Gurnett is a pediatric neurologist, and she's the leader of the precision healthcare in the WashU Clinical and Translational Science NIH Award, on which we are a partner institution. So we posted that link in the chat where you can register for next month. So we did get one question come in. How long does technical and then informatic analysis take?
So technical and informatic analysis, I think what that question was referring to perhaps is how long does it take to sequence let's say as an example, a patient, and then how long does it take to interpret the information, the sequence variation that's obtained as part of that process? The sequencing is very fast, and today actually what's amazing is, for example, some of these infants that are very critically ill, they can turn around sequence information and try to improve the treatment of that infant, save their life in about a 48-hour period. That was really pioneered at Kansas City by Stephen Kingsmore, who's gone on to San Diego. But now there's a lot of groups that are turning this over, this information, very fast. Cancer is a bit slower, but again, there's a lot of competition here, and the onco panels are being offered. Some are FDA approved, some are not. Yeah, we're learning more and more all the time. The numbers, which are critical to really interpretation, are getting up into the millions. And so that's where what we need to see in order to really understand the recurrence and kind of what we're expecting to see for these patients.
So
thank you.
Wes, what difference does it make if they're FDA approved or not? I've heard this come up in other conversations.
Whether they can treat.
Based on
understanding, they can treat the patient if they have, you know, an FDA approved test that they can act on. If it's a research sequencing, then they have to get that CLIA certified sequencing done in order to act on
that period. Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense.
Yes. And then our last question to end the hour is, you mentioned cats. Can you touch on other efforts to sequence tumors across species to better understand biology?
Yeah, I didn't have time and I could do a whole talk on companion animals and working with Dr. Jeff Brine's group here at MU. And dogs, obviously, are the best resource for evaluating cancer comparatively to human. But my lab is very interested in domestic cats who rarely get cancer, and why is the question. And so we think there might be some interesting selection history that, you know, precludes them from getting high incidence of cancer. But dogs, we're looking at a variety of cancer types in the dogs, and then in some cases, very uniquely specific types of cancer in the cat, like oral squamous cell carcinoma is one example.
Thank you.
Well, this is just great, Dr. Warren. Thank you so much. And I think this gives everyone who's listening across the state of Missouri, showing how much on the cutting edge we are in our genomic sequencing capability here at MU. So thank you for being a leader in that.
You're welcome. Glad to share our experiences.